Okay, grade 12s. Today we are going to discuss economics paper one. So the paper was written last week Friday. So guys, remember I always tell you that whenever you are dealing with economics, you should always make sure that you go through all the set was set information and instructions. Why? Because the moment you do that and you understand it, it means that you're not going to encounter any challenge when dealing with the questions or answering the questions. And also, one more thing is that the moment you fail to understand or adhere to the given set of instructions, it means that you have already failed the paper. Why? Because following of instruction is actually considered as one of the one of the core strategies that you should always apply, because the moment you fail to do so, you are going to be negatively affected. Okay, right. So now our paper one is comprising of three sections. We have section A, we have section B, as well as section C. So section A comprises of 30 marks, and in most cases, section A is always compulsory. And then we also have section B, where section B, we are actually given three questions, and the expectation is to answer or select only two questions, of which one question carries 40 marks. Then all in all, they carry 80 marks. Okay, right. So now moving on to section C. Section C contains two questions, of which the expectation is to select one question, of which this one question carries 40 marks. So now 30 marks from section A, 80 marks from section B, and 40 marks from section E, then it's up to 150 marks. Okay, right, grade 12. So now let's check the options. I mean, let's check question one, section A. So now, if you still remember, I always tell you that grade 12s, whenever you are dealing with multiple choice questions, should always apply elimination method. So it means that you should always compare the given set of options before you can just jump onto answer. Because most of the cases, these questions or these answers, they are more or less the same. So any slight mistake, you'll find yourself landing into a mess. Okay, right. So now let's check question one, of which is compulsory, and expectation is to spend 20 minutes on this question. So now this is what at most 20 minutes. It means that you shouldn't exceed 20 minutes whenever you answer this particular type of questions. Okay, right, grade 12. So now 1.1 reads as follows. Various options are provided as possible answers to the following questions. So now choose the answer and write only a letter A to D next to the question numbers. So now inside the bracket, an example is given there when you are given 1.1.1 to 1.1.8. So now you're expected to answer this inside your answer book. So now you're also given an example where it is actually shown that you should only write a letter. Don't also write the information given. Just select a letter of your choice. Okay, right. So now 1.1.1 goes as a follow. When calculating gross domestic expenditure, errors and omissions are counted by a residual item. So now here the correct answer is going to be B. So now moving on to the next question, we have 1.1.2. It reads as follows. The vertical difference between a trough and the next peak of a cycle is known as the amplitude. Okay, right. So now moving on to the next question, we have 1.1.3. 1.1.3 reads as follows. The Minister of Finance presents the medium-term budget policy statement in February of every year. Okay, right. So now let's check 1.1.4. 1.1.4 reads as follows. The difference between tangible exports and tangible imports are called balance of trade. So now if you check here with the options given, we are given trade balance, current transfer, reserve assets, trade deficit. So now the correct answer that is pretty close to balance of trade is what is A. So now A is going to be our answer. Okay, right. So now let's move on to the next question, which is question 1.1.5. Question 1.1.5 reads as follows: the worldwide interfacing and interaction of economies with trade as an important element is called globalization. So meaning our appropriate answer is going to be C. Okay, right, Kritovs. So let's move on to the next question. Next question, we have 1.1.6. So it reads as follows: the form of tax that is levied annually on the market value of residential office buildings is called property tax. So now our appropriate answer is going to be B. So now moving on to next question, we have 1.1.7. It reads as follows: a geographically designated area that has been set aside to develop specific economic activities is known as a special economic zone. So meaning our appropriate answer in this regard is going to be D. Okay, right. So now moving on to 1.1.8, it reads as follows: the human development index of a country with the highest level of development is going to be one, which is C. Okay, right. So now great trials, moving on to the next question, we are given 1.2. So now 1.2 reads as follows: choose a description from column B that matches the item in column A. So write only the letter A I next to the question numbers. So now you are given an example, the inside bracket, where it has been indicated that you have 1.2.1 to 1.2.8 in the answer book. So now also you have been given an example on how to answer this particular question. So now some of the learners, they have the tendency of repeating the given set of information in column B instead of just selecting a letter of their choice. Okay, right, grade 12s. So now moving on, what I can actually advise you, grade 12s, to always pay attention to. So make sure that when you get to column A, check the given set of concepts or the given set of terms. So now after that, before you can actually jump onto column B, create a picture of what is a real flow, what is regulation, what is accountability, what is specialization, what is trade neutrality, what is human development index, what is intellectual property, as well as life expectancy. So now after doing that, create a picture. Don't just be quick to go to this given set of options in column B. So what you must know is that in column B, you are given what features of a concept, you are given functions of a concept, you are given the definitions of a concept. Sometimes you are given the explanations of a concept, and also sometimes you may find that you are given the characteristics of a concept. So now that is why I'm actually saying that you should endeavor understand each and every concept that appear in column A before you can go to the selection of the description of the feature in column B. Okay, right. So now we have real flow. So now real flow is the movement of vectors of production, goods and services among economic participants. So it means that our appropriate answer for 1.2.1 is going to be E. Okay, right. So now moving on to 1.2.2, we have deregulation. So now our appropriate answer in this regard is going to be G, where it says the removal of laws and other forms of the government control that intervene in the functioning of the market. So now here it means our appropriate answer is going to be G. So now we also have 1.2.3, where we have the accountability. So now if you check the accountability, this is when a person is required to give an explanation of his or her own decisions or actions. So now appropriate answer in this regard is going to be A. Okay, right, grade 12s. So now moving on to the next option or next question, we have 1.2.4. So now 1.2.4 is specialization. So now specialization, if we check specialization, it focuses on the production or provision of a particular type of a product. So now it means in this regard, our appropriate answer for what? For 1.2.4 is going to be I. So now I in this regard is going to be our appropriate answer. Okay, right, great talks. So now let's move on to the next question. So now the next question reads as follows. We have trade neutrality. So now when you talk of trade neutrality, we refer to the payment of subsidies that are equal to import duties paid by the export producers. So in this regard, our appropriate answer is going to be F. Okay, right, great talks. So now moving on to the next question, we have 1.2.6, where we have Human Development Index. So now Human Development Index is used by the United Nations to compare the standard of living among different countries. So now it means that in this regard, our appropriate answer is going to be B, where it says used by the United Nations to compare the standards of living among different countries. Okay, right, great talks. So now let's move on to the next one, the next question, where we have intellectual property. So now this intellectual property, we refer to legal ownership of copyright, design, patent or trademark by an individual or business. So in this regard, it means that our appropriate answer is going to be C. Okay, right, great talk. Last but not the least, we have landed on question 1.2.8, where it addresses the issue of life expectancy. So now life expectancy in this regard, we refer to the number of years that a newborn infant is likely to live. So now it means our appropriate answer is going to be D. Okay, right, Kritovs. So now we are done with this question 1.2. Let's quickly jump onto question 1.3. Okay, so now 1.3 reads as follows. Give one term for each of the following descriptions. Write only the term next to the question numbers. We have 1.3.1 to 1.3.6 in the provided answer book. So abbreviations, acronyms, and examples will not be accepted. And I know most of you guys, you have the tendency of writing the abbreviations. So now this one of writing the abbreviation, in most cases, it is not allowed because you are going to score 0 marks. If the question needs you to write a marginal propensity to consume, don't write MPC, because the moment you do that, you are going to score 0 marks. Okay, right, great talks. So now let's check 1.3.1. Okay, when the value of intermediate product is added to the final product when calculating GDP. So now this is nothing but double counting. This is double counting. Okay, right. So now we have 1.3.2. It reads as follows. When all the people who are actively looking for work are able to find jobs or create jobs for themselves, this is nothing but unemployment. I mean what? Employment. This is employment. So now we have 1.3.3. It reads as follows. The price of one currency in terms of another. So now this is nothing but exchange rate. This is exchange rate. Okay, right, great talks. So now moving on, we have 1.3.4. It reads as follows. Measures that artificially restrict the movement of goods and services are among countries. So this is nothing but protectionism. This is protectionism. Protectionism. Okay, right, great talks. So now let's move on to the next question. Next question, we have 1.3.5. It reads as follows. When the central bank convinces commercial banks to act in a manner that is desirable to the prevailing economic conditions, so this is nothing but moral persuasion. This is moral persuasion. Okay, right, great talk. So now let's move on to 1.3.6. It reads as follows. The total industrial capacity of an economy that is available for use is called capacity utilization. Capacity utilize it. Okay, right, great talks. So now we are done with section A. So now we have landed on section B. So now section B reads as follow. As I did explain to you that the expectation here is to select two questions of from the three set of questions given. So now before you can actually select the question that you are going to answer, make sure that you compare the marks that you'll be able to get under each and every question. Don't just jump onto a question because you have seen that there are some two or four marks that you can collect and go home with. Okay, right. So now we have question two, and then this question two, in particular 2.1 says answer the following questions. Then 2.1.1 says name the two vectors that determine the size of the multiplier into a sector model. So now whenever you calculate the multiplier, remember we always use the marginal propensity to save as well as the marginal propensity to consume. So now those are the two aspects that normally influence or determine the size of the multiplier. So now we're saying that we have marginal propensity to save. Also, you have marginal propensity consume. Okay. Right, great talk. So now let's move on to the next question. The next question reads as follows. How can the South African Reserve Bank use open market transactions to increase money supply? So now this is this can actually easily be done when South African Reserve Bank buys security instruments back from commercial banks. So now we are saying that South African Reserve Bank should buy security instruments back from commercial banks. Okay, right, grade 12. So now moving on to next question, we have 2.2, which reads as follow. Study the graph below and answer the questions that follow. So now we have real final consumption expenditure by household for South Africa. And also, if you check, we are also given the keys there where we have durable goods key, also have a semi-durable goods key, and then also have a non-durable good key. Okay, right. So now it reads as follows. 2.2.1. Identify the category of consumer goods that recorded growth in the third quarter of 2002. So now if you check, this is the third quarter. And then if you check, we have durable goods, and durable goods are indicating growth. And why are we saying it does indicate growth? Because now if you check here on the our y-axis, so now these are the increasing numbers from zero upwards. But now if we check here, we have our semi-durable goods as well as non-durable goods. So now if you check here, we start from zero, you have negative one up until negative two. So that on its own shows what it shows, a decline. So now it means our appropriate answer for 2.2.1 is our durable goods. So now we have durable goods. Okay, right, great talks. So now give 2.2.2, it says give one example of non-durable good. So an example of non-durable good can be food. Okay, right. So now briefly describe the term consumption. Consumption is buying of goods and services by household. So you are saying that this is nothing but buying of goods and services by households. Okay, right. So now let's check 2.2.4. So 2.2.4 reads as follows. Why are savings regarded as leakages in the circular flow model? So now savings are regarded as leakages in the circular flow model because it shows money. Money flows from consumers to the banks and is also taken out of the financial cycle. So now we are saying that money flows from consumers to the banks and is taken out of the financial cycle. Same money flows from consumers to the banks and is taken out of the financial circle. Okay, right, grade 12. So now let's check 2.2.5. 2.2.5 reads as follows. How can an increase in interest rates influence households in the circular flow model? So now remember, when interest rates are high, that is the indication that to borrow money from the bank now is going to be very expensive. Because when you talk of the interest rate, we refer to monies that are actually paid on top of the principal amount that has been borrowed from the bank. So now in this regard, if the interest rates are very high, that would be the indication that it will discourage borrowing of money from the commercial banks by household. And also it reduces the spending power of the household. Because now it means that a lot of people are going to be reluctant to go to a different set of banks to take loan. So now we're saying that it will discourage borrowing of money from the commercial banks by household. Okay, right. Then also said that it reduces the spending power or pattern of the household. Okay, right, grade 12. So now let's move on to the next question. Next question, we have 2.3. So now 2.3 reads as follows. Study the extract below and answer the questions that follow. So now the extract reads as follows. The privatization and restructuring program in South Africa. So the South African approach to privatization has been one of the restructuring of state-owned enterprises, so SOEs. So now the goals of restructuring have been to reduce government borrowing requirements and to extend private ownership to historically disadvantaged groups. So, however, little has been achieved as restructuring efforts have been slow and reluctant. Okay, right. So now we have 2.3.1. It says identify a term that refers to parastatal. So now the term is state-owned enterprises. State-owned enterprises, SOE. Okay, right. So now 2.3.2 reads as follow. Give one feature of the public sector a failure. So one feature of the public sector failure can be lack of motivation. So now we're saying that lack of motivation. Okay, right. So now also have 2.3.3 reads as follow. Briefly describe the term nationalization. So now when we describe the term nationalization, we're saying that nationalization occurs when the government takes over the running of a privately owned enterprises and makes it state owned. Okay. So now we are on 2.3.3. So now we are saying that nationalization occurs when the government takes over the running of a privately owned enterprises and makes it state owned. Okay, right, great talks. So now let's move on to 2.3.5 reads as follows. How can the South African government benefit from privatization of a state-owned enterprise? How can the South African government benefit from the privatization of state-owned enterprise? Okay, so now the South African government is going to benefit in the sense that there will be promotion of economic development and also economic growth. So now here we are saying 2.3.4. So this is via promotion of economic growth and economic development. So now remember, when we talk of economic growth, so now this one is in line in terms of what, in terms of improvement of production of goods and services by firms. So now also we have economic development. So now economic development, we refer to improvement of the standard of living, by the household. So now that is that. So now great talks, in most cases whenever you're answering the questions under economics, make sure that you understand the concept. But because the moment you don't understand the concept, that is going to pose the challenge when it comes to answering as the questions under study. Okay, right, great talks. So now we have landed on question 2.4. So now 2.4 reads as follows. Discuss the role of household in the circular flow model. So now, Craig Trofts, if you still remember the concept circular flow model, circular flow model, we refer to a model that indicates the flow of production, the flow of income, as well as the flow of expenditure amongst the market participants. Okay, right. So now let's check the role of the roles of households in the circular flow model. So now we are saying that 2.4, we are checking the roles of what roles of households in the circular flow model. Okay, right. So now one of the roles of the household under circular flow model, households pay taxes to the government, such as tax, also value-added tax, and then also households supply vectors of production to firms. Why? Because households are considered to be the primary owners of vectors of production. So now also you are saying that households buy goods and services from the firms so that they can as well use such goods and services. Also, households do not spend all their income on goods and services. So now it means that saving is done to financial institutions such as banks, insurance companies, as well as assurance. Okay, right. So we are saying that households pay taxes. Households pay taxes to the government. Pay taxes to the government, such as value-added tax, income tax, company tax, value added tax and income tax, as well as etc. Okay, right. So now also the second one, we are saying that households supply vectors. Households are the primary. Households are the primary owners of the vectors of production, and they sell these vectors of production to the firms in the vector market. Okay, right. So now the third one, you are saying that households buy goods and services from the firms. Then the last one, but not the least, you are saying that households do not spend all their income on buying goods and services, but rather savings is done to financial institutions, financial institutions such as banks, insurance companies, shares, and etc. Okay, right, great talk. So now you're saying that the roles of household in the circular flow model, households pay taxes to the government, such as value-added tax, as well as income tax, and etc. So now also we are saying that households are the primary owners of the vectors of production, and they sell these vectors of production to the firms in the vector market. Also, we are saying that households buy goods and services from the firms. So now we also say that households do not spend all their income on buying goods and services. Part of the income, they go for savings. So that is why we're saying saving is done to financial institutions such as banks, insurance companies, as well as shares. Okay, right, grade 12. So now we have landed on question what? We have now landed on question five. So now question five needs us to analyze the vectors that may cause a deficit on South African balance of payment. Remember, when you talk of South African balance of payment, balance of payment, we refer to a statement that records the transactions in line with our imports and exports. Okay, right. So now let's check the analysis in terms of how this vectors may cause a deficit on South African balance of payment. Okay, right. So now we're saying that we are now on question 2.5. So now we're saying that an increment in the level of imports, power shortages, and network constraints on exports. And also, we are saying that the deficit on the services, income, and current transfer account is a ratio of GDP remained unchanged at 3% in the third quarter of 2023. So now also we are saying that increasingly South Africa's current account deficit is caused by the interest and dividend payments to foreign investors. And lastly, but not the least, we are saying that for the year 2022, deficit on the services, income, and current transfer account widened to 253 billion in March 2023. Okay, right. We are saying that an increment in the level of imports, the level of imports, power shortages, and network constraints on exports. Okay, right. So now the next one, we are saying that the deficit on the services, deficit on the services, income, and current transfer account is a ratio of GDP remained unchanged at 3% in the third quarter of of 2023. Okay, right. So now we also seen that increasingly, South Africa Africa's current account deficit is caused by interest and dividend, caused by interest and dividend payments to foreign investors. Okay, right. So now also the last point, you are saying that for the year 2022, deficit on the services income and current transfer account widened $253 billion in March 2023. Okay, right. We are saying that an increment in the level of imports, power shortages, and network constraints on exports. And also we are saying that the deficit on the services income and current transfer account is a ratio of GDP remained unchanged at 3% in the third quarter of 2023. And also, increasingly, South Africa's current account deficit is caused by interest and dividends payments to foreign investors. And last but not the least, we are saying that for the year 2022, the deficit on the services income and current transfer account widened to $253 billion in March. Okay, right. So now, Kritovs, we are done with our question two. Let's now jump on to question three. So now, let's check what question three has in store for us. So now, question three reads as follows. Answer the following questions. Name any two redress policies in South Africa. So now, these redress policies that we have economic justice policy, we have Employment Equity Act of 1998. So now here we are saying that we have economic justice policy, and also we have employment Equity Act of 1998. So now those are the redress policy that we have in store. Okay, right. So now let's check 3.1.2. 3.1.2 reads as follows. How can import substitution promote industrialization? Import substitution can easily promote industrialization by targeting the protection and incubation of newly formed domestic industries, to fully develop sectors today, to so that the goods produced are competitive with imported goods. Come again. So now we're saying that how can import substitution promote industrialization? So now industrialization can actually be promoted by targeting the protection and incubation of newly formed domestic industries to fully develop the sectors, so the goods produced are competitive with imported goods. Okay, right. You're saying that by targeting the protection and incubation of newly formed domestic industries, to fully develop sectors, so the goods produced are comparative with imported goods. Okay. Right, grade 12. So now let's move on to 3.2. So now 3.2 reads as follow. Study the extract below and answer the questions that follow. So now we have the effects of dumping. So now remember, dumping is when unwanted goods are actually being sold to other countries with the cheaper amount or lower prices. So now dumping involves substantial export volumes of products, and it often endangers the financial viability of manufacturers of our producers in importing countries. So now also we are given the set of information that says the biggest disadvantage of dumping is the ability to flood a market with product prices that are often considered unfair. So therefore, countries use tariffs and quotas so as to protect their domestic producers from such dumping behavior. So now 3.2.1 reads as follows. Identify a form of tax imposed on imports in the extract above. So now the appropriate answer is what? Tariffs. Okay, right, grade 12. So now 3.2.2 reads as follows. Name the international trade policy that protects local producers from unfair competition. So now that is what protectionism. Protectionism. Okay, right, grade 12. So now we also have 3.2.3. That reads as follows. Briefly describe the term import quota. So now when we talk of import quota, we refer to imposed limits on the quantity of a certain good that can be imported into a country. So now who set the limit? The government is the one that sets the limit. So now we are saying that import quota, we refer to nothing but government imposed limits, whose limits on the quantity of a certain good that can be imported into the country. Okay, right, grade 12. So now we have 3.2.4. So now 3.2.4 is as follow. Explain the role of the World Trade Organization in promoting free trade. What they do, they make sure that they reduce or eliminate trade barriers. Eliminating trade barriers. Okay, right. So now let's check 2.2.5 reads as follows. How can dumping impact on consumers in the importing country? Consumers benefit from lower prices, and also consumers' purchasing power is going to increase. Saying that consumers benefit from lower prices, and also consumers' purchasing power increases. So now those are the impacts on consumers in line with dumped goods into the certain country. Okay, right, grade 12. So now we are done with 3.2.5. Now we have landed on question 3.3. So study the map below and answer the questions that follow. Global North and Global South. So now if you check, we have a Global North, and then we also have Global South. So now the question reads as follows. Identify the letter that represent developed countries in a map. So the letter that shows developed countries in a map is letter A. So now this is the divide. This is the divide. This is the divide. This is the divide from this is the divide of economically developed countries and economically developing countries. So now this one is economically developing countries. So this one is economically developed countries. Okay, okay, right, grade 12. So now let's check 3.3.2. Name one aspect or element related to the standard of living. We have life expectancy. Can be life expectancy or income per capita or income per capita. Okay. Okay, right, grade 12. So now let's move on to question 3.3. So question 3.3.3 reads as follows. Briefly describe the term or the concept North-South divide. So North-South divide is the division between economically developed countries and economically developing countries. Saying that it is a divide between economically developed countries and economically developing countries. Okay, right, grade 12. So now we have 3.3.4. So now 3.4 reads as follows. How can economic activities in the north impact on the environment? So now it can impact on the environment by providing the market with environmentally friendly goods. Providing providing the market with economically environment friendly goods. Okay, right. So now let's check 3.3.5. It says, explain the challenges faced by developing countries when trading with developed countries. So now we have lack of competitiveness by the developing countries. Lack of competitiveness by the developing countries. Another one, reduction of low standard, goods by developing countries. Okay, right. So now let's check reads, discuss industrial development zones as South Africa's initiative in regional development. So now this industrial development zones promote quality exports that will pay or needed exports, and also promote job creation . Poverty must be alleviated. Okay, right. Also promote and develop links between domestic and zone industries. And lastly, enable exploitation of resources. Okay. Right, grade 12. So now we are done with question 3.4. So now let's move on to 3.5. So now 3.5 reads as follows: analyze the reasons why South African consumers prefer imported goods and services. So now South African consumers mostly prefer imported goods and services. Why? Because are produced more efficiently and cheaply abroad. So these goods and services, they are mostly produced efficiently and cheaply from abroad. And also, the domestic industries cannot produce as efficiently or cheaply as exporting country. And also, South Africa depends on global trade for a range of goods and services. And lastly, but not the least, importing allows consumers to access a broader variety of goods and services at significantly lower prices. Okay, right. So now you're saying that for question 3.5, you're saying that produced more efficiently and cheaply abroad. Okay. And also their domestic industries cannot produce as efficiently or cheaply as exporting country. And also we are saying that South Africa depends on global trade for a range of goods and services. And also, we are saying that importing allows consumers to access a broader variety of goods, services, greater variety of goods and services at significantly lower prices. Okay, right. So now we are saying that the question says, analyze the reasons why South African consumers prefer imported goods and services. So now we are saying that South Africa prefer imported goods or services because most of the produced goods and services from abroad, they are more efficient and also are cheap. And also we are saying that the domestic industries cannot produce as efficiently or cheaply as exporting countries. So now also we're saying that South Africa depends on global trade for a range of goods and services. And also we're saying that importing allows consumers access a broader variety of goods and services at significantly lower prices. Okay, right, grade 12s. So now let's move on to the next question. So now the next question, we have question 4. So now question 4 reads as follows. So now in particular, 4.1, answer the questions that follow. So now when we check 4.1.1, reads as follows. Name any two financial incentives used by South African government so as to improve industrial development. So now, one of the incentives that we can talk of, we refer to duty-free incentives. And another one, we have regional incentives. So now let's check 4.1.2. So 4.1.2 reads as follows. Why does the government strive to keep public debt at least 60% of gross domestic product? This is because the government should always aim at achieving higher economic growth, because the government aims due to an aim of achieving higher economic growth. So remember, when you talk of economic growth, we refer to an improvement in terms of production of goods and services by firms or businesses. Okay, right. So now let's check 4.2. 4.2 reads as follows. Study the table below and answer the questions that follow. So now we have South African rents, annual history exchange rate. So now we have two columns, where one column, the first column denotes a number of years, and also we have what we have in the next column. That shows average exchange rate. So now, if you check the years, we have 2018, 2019, 2020, 2021, as well as 2022. So now, also on average exchange rate, we have where $1 is equivalent to 13 rand 26 cents in 2018, and also in 2019, we have where $1 is equivalent to 14 rands 49 cents. In 2020, we have $1 which is equivalent to 16 rands 46 cents. So now also we have 2021, where $1 is equivalent to 14 rands 80 cents, and we also have 2022, where $1 is equivalent to 16 rands 38 cents. Okay, right. So now 4.2.1 reads as follows. Identify in the table above the year in which the value of the rand was strongest. So now if you check the value of the rand that was strongest, it's when we have what? When we have 2018. So now 2018, if you check 2018, that's when now the value of rand is somehow very high. So now here we have 2018 as the answer for 4.2.1. So now let's check 4.2.2. 4.2.2 reads as follows. Name the exchange rate system used in South Africa. So now the exchange rate system used in South Africa is now flexible exchange rate system. So now we are saying this is nothing but flexible exchange rate system. Okay, right, great talks. So now let's check 4.2.3. So now 4.2.3 reads as follows. Briefly describe the term depreciation in relation to exchange rate. So now when you talk of depreciation, is when the value of a currency decreases in terms of another currency. So now we're saying that this is when the value of a currency decreases in terms of another currency. Okay, right. So now let's check 4.2.4. So 4.2.4 reads as follows. How can the government directly intervene in the foreign exchange market when the local currency is undervalued? So now the moment the local currency is undervalued, it means that now the government or the South African Reserve Bank should reevaluate the South African rand. So now we are saying that the South African government, government or South African Reserve Bank should evaluate the South African rand. Okay, right, great talks. So now let's move on to the next question. So now the next question reads as follows. 4.2.5. Draw correctly labeled diagram to show the effects on an increase in demand for US dollars in South Africa. So now we have to draw the demand and the supply of this. So now here we have the quantity of dollars, then decide we have the price. This one is rents per dollars. So now we have the supply curve. We also have the demand curve one, and also have the demand curve two. We have quantity one, we have quantity two, we have price one, we have price two, and now this shows an increase level of the price, and also here the quantity also shows an increase. So here we have E1 and then E2. So now this is nothing but how we saw the increase in demand for US dollars in South Africa. So now the expectation is to come with a graph like this. Okay, right, grade 12s. Let's move on to the next question. So now the next question reads as follows. Study the information below and answer the questions that follow. So now, the four industrial revolution, the focus of industrial development has evolved over the past centuries. So now we have A, where we have 1765, also have B, where we have 1870, we also have 1965, which is C, and then we have D, which is today. So now if you check in 1965, you have mechanization, and then 1870, we have mass production, then 1965, we have automated production, while today we have new technologies. Okay, right. So now 4.3.1 reads as follows. Identify the picture using the letters above that represent the fourth industrialization revolution. So now in this regard, our appropriate answer is going to be D. So now the next question reads as follows. Name the government department that is responsible for promoting industrial development in South Africa. So that is trade, industry, and competition. So it's trade, industry, and competition. Okay, right. So now let's check 4.3.4. So now 4.3.4 reads as follows. Explain the influence of skill shortages on industrial development. So now the moment there's a skill shortage, that is the indication that is the processing, that is the indication that explain the influence. Oh, sorry, we have 4.3.3, where briefly you are supposed to describe the term manufacturing. So now when you talk of manufacturing, we refer to the processing of goods from raw resources to a finished product. Processing of goods from raw resources, a finished product. Okay, right. So now we also have 4.3.4. So 4.3.4 reads as follows. Explain the influence of skill shortages on industrial development. So the moment there is a skill shortages, there will be reluctant growth in industrial development. So we are saying that there will be reluctant growth in industrial development. Okay, right. So now let's check 4.3.5. So 4.3.5 reads as follows. How can the national research and development strategy help to improve the South African economy? So now we're saying that this can be done by establishing and funding of a range of technology. So mission that are critical to promote economic and social development. So now we're saying that establishing and funding of a range of a range of technologies missions that are critically or critical to promote economic and social development. Okay. Right, great talks. So now let's check 4.4. Discuss the necessity of the public sector. So now let's check the necessity of the public sector, which is 4.4. So now we are saying that public sector is needed in terms of market failure. So now if the market failed, we need the public sector to be there in the game, or to bring the rules of the game, so as to prevent market failure, which occurs when the free market forces of supply and demand fail to lead to an efficient allocation of resources. And also we need the government in terms of the provision of public goods. So we mean that the supply, the government supplies with our community goods, merit goods, and collective goods that are needed by the inhabitants of South Africa. And again, the government is needed, or there is a need for the government due to existence of externality. So now the government should be there to encourage positive externalities, because those are beneficial what commodities to consume. And also the government should be there so as to discourage negative externalities. Remember, negative externalities, we refer to those goods and services that are very harmful to consume. And also we're saying that the government is needed so as to protect natural resources. So now the moment the government protect the use of natural resources in the country so as to avoid the damage on them. Okay, right. So now we're saying that the market failure, we need the government for the sake of market failure. Okay, let's move on to this is 4.4. So we are saying this for the sake of market failure. So now to prevent market failure, which occurs when the free market forces of demand and supply fail to lead to an efficient efficient allocation of resources. And also we are saying that provision of public goods the government would supply the economy with community goods merit goods and collective goods. And also, we are saying that we need the government for the existence of externalities. Government should encourage the use of the positive externality because they are beneficial to be consumed. And the government should discourage the use of negative externality because they are harmful to consume. Okay. Right, so now another one. They're saying that to protect natural resources, protection of natural resources, of natural resources. So we are saying that government should protect use of natural resources in the country, avoid damage on the environment. Okay, so now those are the reasons for the necessity of the public sector. Okay, right, Kritovs. So now let's move on to 4.5. So now 4.5 reads as follows: how does the South African government use fiscal policy so as to improve the standard of living? Remember, the fiscal policy is the governmental policy where it uses two instruments, which is the government spending and taxation. So now, saying that 4.5, same fiscal policy, is a governmental policy that uses government spending and taxation to stimulate the economy. Okay, so we are saying that improve garment should spend more and reuse the level of taxation. Also, you have seen that expansionary policy fiscal policy and fiscal policy attempt contain economic slump and stimulate economic activity. Okay, right, grade 12. So now at this juncture, we are done with section B. Let's quickly move on to section C. Okay, right. So section C, what you should always bear in mind with, you should always make sure that you master your concept. So now of all the sections, this is the simplest section ever. Why is it the simplest section ever? And then it's because it contains different set of concepts where you must exercise your understanding of the concepts. And remember, I always tell you that if you want to master economics essay, make sure that you understand the concept. Don't memorize the concept, because the moment you memorize the concept, that is going to pose a challenge to you. Okay, right. So now let's check here. So now we have what the structure of the paper. You must always have your introduction. So now this is going to be your body. It's going to be your body. So now 26 marks is going to show main body, and then 10 marks is going to be additional part. And then after that, you should have your own conclusion. So the same thing applies. We have introduction. So here is going to be body. And then 26 marks shows main body. And then 10 marks, we have additional part. So now also, you must have your own conclusions. Okay, right. So now under the introduction part, in particular question 5, you are supposed to discuss in detail the new economic paradigm in smoothing out of the business cycle. So now what do we mean by business cycle? So now it means that under introduction, you are going to define business cycle. So when you talk of the business cycle, we refer to upswings and downswings of the economic activities, or we refer to the fluctuations of the economic activities. So now how do we smooth out the business cycle? So now, guys, if you still remember, this is how the business cycle behaves. So now when you smooth out the business cycle, you are trying by all means to get rid of what the rate of too much fluctuations. So now in order for the word in the economy to smooth out the business cycle should apply two policies, either fiscal policy or monetary policy. So now when you talk of the fiscal policy is the governmental policy, which uses two instruments, be it government spending and taxation. So now it does depend on the behavior of what? On the behavior of an economy. The moment the economy is at boom, remember the economy, when the economy is at boom, it shows that there is a full employment of resources. So now all the economic activities are performing very well. So now in that regard, it means that now the government is going to what is going to cut too much spending, but they are going to charge more taxes. Why? Because the economy is now performing well. It means in that regard, the company tax is going to increase, the income tax is going to increase, value added tax as well, or in the same manner, it's going to increase. So now moving on to the side of the monetary policy. Monetary policy is a policy that is actually being used by the South African Reserve Bank. So now it uses two instruments in this regard, which is interest rate and money supply. So now the moment the economy is at boom, it means that now there's going to be an increase in interest rate and a decrease in money supply. So there's no way that these two concepts or these two instruments can go towards the same direction. Okay, right. So now let's check when the economy is at the trough. When the economy is at trough, it means that there's poor performance of economic activities. So now the policies that should be implemented should encourage the production of goods and services, and also should encourage the standard of living of the inhabitants. So now the moment the economy is at trough, it means that now on the side of the fiscal policy, the government supposed to spend more and cut the tax charge, because the moment they do that, they are going to encourage production of goods and services by businesses, and also they are going to encourage productivity per person in that regard. And also let's move on to the side of the monetary policy. Under monetary policy, it means that the moment the economy is at trough, now the monetary policy is going to cut too much interest rates, so that it can encourage individuals and businesses to go to different financial providers to take loans. But now when it comes to money supply is going to increase. Okay, right, grade 12. So now let's check the additional part. The additional part says, how can an increase in economic activity impact on household, impact on businesses? So the moment economic activities are very high, it means that now the businesses are going to produce mass volume of goods and services. So in that regard, it means that now businesses are going to be able to pay tax to the government. Businesses are going to be able to produce a lot of goods and services, so that they can sell locally and the excess can be sold to other countries. And also the moment we have an increase in economic activities, it means that now businesses are going to collect enough profits. After collecting enough profits, they are now going to expanding the businesses towards opening more branches. And the moment they try to open more branches, it means that now they are going to create jobs, opportunities for the household. Okay, right. So now let's check the conclusion. When it comes to conclusion, grade 12s, make sure that whatsoever opinion, whatsoever view that you have didn't appear on your body as well as on your introduction. Okay, right. So now we are done with question 5. Let's move on to question 6. So now question 6, we are supposed to discuss in detail the various economic indicators. Then additional part, how can a social indicator assist the government in improving decision making? So in this regard, we are going to explain a word, economic indicator. Before we explain economic indicator, what does it mean? What does it mean when you talk of a word indicator? When you talk of an indicator under economics, we refer to a sign that shows where an economy is heading. So now the moment we talk of the sign that is economic, it means that it is a sign that involves production of goods and services, or it's a sign that involves money. Okay, Right. So now, most of the economic activities that we can actually, or economic indicators that we can actually pay attention to, we can check out the production of goods and services. The moment there is higher production of goods and services in an economy, it means that the economy is going to benefit. Why? Because now they will be able to even export to other countries. And remember, it is healthy for an economy to export more than the import, because exports are considered as the injections, and also import are considered as the leakage from the economy. So now remember, it is so healthy for an economy to always have more of the injections than leakages. Why is that the case? Why is that the case? Because the moment you have more of the injections than leakages, that is the indication that we have more money, or we have the inflow of money into the economy than the outflow of money into the economy. Okay, right, great talks. So now, also under the economic indicators, we can have the likes of the prices of goods and services. The moment businesses are able to charge reasonable prices of goods and services, it means that that is going to give households and other participants in the market the flexibility afford those are goods and services. So now in essence, or as a result, it means that there won't be any waste of resources. So it means that resources are going to be efficient, or resources are going to be efficiently used. Okay, right. And also we can check the issue of the price stability. Price stability, what do you refer to when you say that? It means that there shouldn't be any fluctuation in terms of the prices that have been charged by businesses. It means that businesses should always charge what are fixed prices, even though we are not saying fixed as such, but there shouldn't be too much change in the level of our prices, because that one on its own can cause a price hike for one commodity, or it can cause inflation when it is now taking place in general prices. Okay, right, great talks. So now, also, let's check how can social indicators assist the government in improving decision making. So now, guys, remember, when you talk of social indicators, we are talking over the indicators or the signs that are in line with the society. The signs such as poverty, the signs such as life expectancy, the signs such as nutrition and the likes. So now, if we have, how can the social indicators assist the government improving decision making? So now, if the government is in a position to see the extent or the level of poverty that is prevailing in a country, it means that the government should revise its policies. The moment they attack that poverty, they come up with a proper policy to address such issue. And also, when we talk of the nutrition as well, so the government should know which policy should be derived in terms of solving the issue of poor nutrition. And also, when it comes to healthcare facilities, the government should know as well the approach that they should take into account the moment they actually approach the issue of the health facility. Okay, great talks. So now, remember, when it comes to conclusion, as much as I did tell you guys, make sure that whatsoever information that appears on your conclusion doesn't appear on your body, doesn't appear on your introduction. So now, at this juncture, great talks, I would love to say thank you very much. Hopefully you did enjoy the lesson. Shalom.